Please welcome Rapporteur on Sports, Governance of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe and Member of the Parliament of Denmark from the Social Democratic Party, Mogens Jensen. The Deputy Secretary General of the OECD, Kiviniemi. Director of the Division of Policy Analysis and Public Affairs at UNODC, Jean-Luc Lemahieu. Canadian Rhythmic Gymnastics, Olympian and Marketing Director of the Pan American Sports Organization, Alexandra Orlando. And President of the Association of Summer Olympic International Federations, Francesco Ricci Bidi. Moderating our panel is BBC News presenter, Razia Iqbal.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for staying for the final session. That's most encouraging. We didn't have the chance to say this outside. Can I just ask each of the panelists just to pull the microphone in towards you so that we can be sure that everyone's going to be able to hear you? We are talking about integrity in institutions for the last session before the award ceremony, combating corruption in sport. Pretty important and sensitive issue. It is arguable that pretty much everything that we have heard today, not just on this stage, but also in the working zones, the initiatives on women in sport, determined effort to use sport to engender values that go beyond the actual playing of sport, respect, friendship, we heard that from the president this morning, combating doping, protecting athletes, preventing harassment, abuse, all of those things, transparency being very important, all of those things are not possible if institutions are not trusted. And that's why this session feels so critical. That's why it feels so important, because pretty much everything is affected by the strength of the institutions who are able to implement the values, the value system, the morality, all of the things that we've heard about today. So I'm going to start straight away with Francesco, since you are on the board of the IOC. I wonder if you feel that the IOC is at a point where there's a confidence that you are tackling the corruption, that you're across it, you're aware of it, and what's going to happen from now on will ensure that it won't happen again and that the stain of corruption in international sporting institutions won't occur.
First of all, I would like to say that representing sport, we are not so sick as we are represented in this time of mediatization of sport. So we had surely some case of corruption, very, very well known, and that attracts so much attention, but we have also a lot of work, positive work, in terms of attacking the governance problem. Our organization are traditionally based on autonomy, large autonomy, so autonomy should not be a permission to have bad practice, but autonomy should be used in a good sense. And obviously this is one of the points to grow the culture of good governance is the first point. To cope with this. But I want to mention also a value that is not very often mentioned in sport. The value that we, international organization of sport, value a lot is the credibility. Sport, the difference between sport and other entertainment activity is that we need credibility, and the credibility on the field and off the field. So this has to be taken care of, and we try to take care. Right? It's not. Now, I don't want to take so much time to describe what we are doing. Perhaps at a later stage, I will say what we are doing. But in general terms, inside our organization, we tackle the governance. Culture of better governance is also a very, is always a very good tool. Specifically, we are very active in the three great specific areas, anti-doping, and I can list all the activity of the Olympic movement on this matter. Anti-match fixing or anti-corruption, if you want. This is a younger problem, but issue, but I believe that is also due to the new technology, the internet and international betting And the third one, as you mentioned in your introduction, is what the British call very, with nice word, welfare policy, that is all the abuse in sport, if you want the translation. So these are the three areas in which we have a governance, a general area, and we have specific areas in which we are very active. So I would like to stress that sport perhaps is the leading area. And we open ourselves to the authority. Sport cannot solve all the problems. We need the public authority, and in this sense, we have a lot of cooperation, but I leave my friend Morgan Jensen to talk about that.
Well, let's turn to Morgan Jensen. I mean, Francesco, it's interesting that you talk about not being as sick as perhaps it's perceived to be, but there clearly is a credibility issue. And one of the things that credibility can benefit from, or at least you can shape credibility, is when you have a strong system of regulation. Mogens, tell us exactly what it is that you have been trying to do to try and put structures in place that make it possible for other organizations to stand alongside the IOC, for instance.
Yes, thank you. I'm here both as a national parliamentarian, but also with my work in the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, to argue that we all need to take more responsibility. It's for sure that the Olympic movement has to take much more responsibility, and it starts up with agreeing on a set of global standards on good governance.
The implication of saying that the IOC needs to take more responsibility is that it hasn't to date.
It has taken, as Francesca was saying, steps has been taken, but you have to take more steps, and you have to take them more rapidly. And I think the first thing is to agree before 2020 on a set of global standards, and put in place a monitoring system which relies to all sports organizations, and so that you have the standards and you are enabled to control and monitor that each part of the sports movement live up to these standards. Of course, that cannot guarantee that people will do so, but having the standards defined and having the monitoring system in place is the basic in order to do something about this. And there, I think, a big step has to be taken. And then on the government side or on the parliamentarian side, our task is, of course, to put up the proper regulation framework supporting anti-corruption laws. A good example now is Switzerland, that just recently changed their legislation. 60 sports federations have their headquarters in Switzerland, and they changed their legislation so that being a sports leader there, you are considered as a special person when it comes to tax and openness about tax, so you can see into these persons' economic situation. That's a big improvement of a loophole in the legislation in Switzerland. But also when it comes to law enforcement, we all know if the FBI didn't put a lot of effort into the FIFA scandal, then you would never had been able to do something about the FIFA scandal. So also putting resources into law enforcement is the responsibility of governments and parliaments. And finally, I would say on sponsors, they also have to be much more critical about who they choose to support and have some ethic standards for their way of supporting through sponsorships.
Well, that's quite a lot that you've outlined. I wonder if we can just build on what you've just said and turn to Marie. So you are the Deputy Secretary General of the OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. What is your interest and involvement in trying to ensure that there is good governance in sporting institutions?
So first of all, we have cooperated with the International Olympic Committee during decades earlier, but very occasionally. But now during last 2 years, we have intensified our cooperation, and that has happened via two avenues. First of them is the creation of international partnership against corruption in sports. We have together, for example, with Council of Europe and with governments, then formed three task forces, of which the OECD leads two of them, where we try to find solutions on how to get rid of corruption in procurement, and then also how to get rid of corruption in selection of sport events.
Would you say that in the two areas that you've just mentioned, would you say that this is not a difficult thing to do if you put your mind to it?
It is challenging, but I didn't mention the other avenue where we have cooperated, and that is where the International Olympic Committee actually supported the creation of OECD recommendation on global events and local development, which is a toolkit will be created later, but which is a set of recommendations to countries how to make sure that also integrity is respected in organizing these big events, and also the social and environmental dimension, and via these recommendations, which can be used by governments and also sports organizations, you can really get benefits widely also to the local level. But based on the long-standing work of the OECD in advising governments in good governance, anti-corruption, public integrity issues, also how to get rid of corruption in public procurement, we also think that we can use that expertise also in the world of sports, and happy to cooperate also in the future, and especially via these IPACs task force groups.
Okay, so from the point of view of an athlete, Alexandra, just tell us what your experience has been and why this is important. Why is this issue of critical importance to the way in which sport is played?
Well, first of all, I just wanted to say thank you, you know, so much for having me speak on behalf of the athletes here and a part of such an incredible panel. It's quite an honor, and this is, as you said, such a critical issue right now. And I wanted to firstly say that athletes and the perspective from our athletes, no matter how big or small the corruption at any kind, at any level, is just absolutely unacceptable, and it's not what we stand for, and it's not what the rings stand for. And I think that when we're having the conversation, we need to keep reminding ourselves of that. And that our athletes, if they truly are at the heart and the center of everything that we do, we need to hold ourselves accountable. We need to hold ourselves to the level of excellence in which our athletes are training every single day, pushing themselves mentally, physically, making the impossible possible. That is what we do for the love of sport and to be a part of this movement. And we expect the institutions around us to hold themselves to that level as well. And these are institutions that are meant to protect us, to have those safeguards in place where we feel as though we have a relationship that we can work on together to improve sport. We've talked so much today about leveraging the power of sport to better the world and to better all of us. And I think there's a role to play. I would say that, from my personal opinion, we need to really look at where do athletes fit into the solution? How can we help? How can we be advocates for change at all levels? Because it's not just at a high level or even at the Olympic level. It's looking at all the different layers and complexities throughout the sports system, and where can we really make a change? Where can we help regulate a little bit better? And how do we educate our athletes so that they're not only aware of some of the issues, but have a way to actually speak out about certain corruption without any repercussions? And I think there's a lot of layers to it. But when an athlete feels like an outcome or a decision is taken out of their hands, that they don't have control of that outcome. That's when you really see the relationship diminish and actually erode the trust and the loyalty that we have with our institutions and the organizations that govern us.
Jean-Luc, when you listen to Alexandra talking about why this matters and where responsibility lies, it's quite clear from what we've heard so far that responsibility has to be taken by absolutely everybody. But there are clearly difficulties in trying to connect. And if it's the case that an international body like the IOC can't do everything on its own, what can an institution like the UN offer as a stakeholder in that context?
Thank you very much. I mean, for allowing me to be here today as well with you in this panel. Well, the fact that we have this panel, that we have so many different stakeholders from different levels, from the athletes, I mean, to the OECD, I mean, to the Council of Europe, to the OEC as well, is clearly indicative about how we have analyzed the problem and that we need to situate this problem in a collaborative effort. The IOC can only go so far, but if the governments have not criminalized the corruption by itself, then there is impunity, then there is permissiveness. So we need to lock that door. Now, this is exactly where UNODC has a small contribution to make sure that we come to a playing field, I mean, among different governments, where we do have a criminal justice system in place, which does not only criminalize the corruption, does well make sure that there is a prosecution, that there is an investigation, that there is a due process to be followed. Things which are not necessarily in the hands of the IOC. So that is the collaborative effort which we need to undertake. Now, by the same, what Alexander was saying is very important. I mean, the IOC has to provide a protective environment for the athlete. And in that framework, again, the United Nations, through the Convention Against Corruption, has a set of series from whistleblower protection to, you just name it, put forward, which can help you with the governance of the anti-corruption frame.
I wonder, Marie, if you would just reflect for us a little on not so much the need for good governance inside the IOC. You know, we know that the IOC is looking to make many reforms, so we're in a kind of dynamic situation here in which the IOC is clearly responding to the difficulties. But there is also the issue of countries who host the Olympics. So, for example, Brazil and Korea. When you see that the Olympics throws a spotlight on a country, and in the case of those two countries, they were absolutely mired in corruption scandals that were endemic to that country. It was nothing to do with the IOC. But given that the Olympics throws a spotlight on these countries, there is something about perception, isn't there, that needs to be tackled.
Yes, it really is a question of the culture, which kind of culture you have in the country, and where you stand when you have a look at the listing on how corrupted the country is. And I like very much that every one of you said that this is really in everyone's hands. You need the governments, you need the international organization, you need the sports organization in order to create the culture which definitely says no to corruption. But we all know that it is a challenging environment, despite of the fact that there are so many recommendations from the UN, also from the OECD, to which many countries had adhered to and kind of promised that we will follow these integrity rules, for example. Still, the compliance is not there. So a lot needs to be done, and there we also hope that we can help by different toolkits to governments how to make it really happen. So that best practices.
Let's talk about that, because best practice is clearly something that needs to be put in place. Francesco, what does best practice look like to you? How does it look? What does good governance look like?
We start a project of good governance just in 2015 for our federation. And the overall finding was very interesting. We start We had five criteria: transparency, democracy, control mechanism, develop solidarity, that is an important activity of all the international organization, and 50 indicators, and we start this analysis. And the overall finding was very interesting. As I say, we are in the third stage. We did already two. And a very good overall finding is that the second step was much better than the first one. So that means that only to start the project was a very positive incentive for all the federation to do what they can do, because obviously according to their constitution, they can do something without at the board level, they could do something at the annual general meeting level, so that is more complicated, it depends. But they did already, all of them. For instance, we had more or less 50% of published audited account, and now we have 23 on 28, and some of the five, they already published something in their website. So these are huge, in my opinion, results. Then we did some statistic, and we saw that the federations that have term limits are usually better than the one that are in sports. There is a tradition of long leadership, and so this is another matter that has to be tackled in the future, because as obviously the pro and cons. But
not being tackled at the moment.
No. My position is that I can reassure you anyhow that the sport movement is putting so much engagement, but we cannot tackle the full problem. We need the public authority, because sport movement by definition can take care of the elite of the sport, but the sport non-competitive, the sport for all, where you have to disseminate the message of the value of sport, in this field we need the cooperation. I was creating behind the creation of the first perhaps integrity unit in terms of match fixing in my sport, that was tennis at that time in 2010, because it was starting to be a problem. And I remember very well that how many times I was frustrated, because we needed the cooperation of at least three agencies by the government. The legislation, we need law, because otherwise we need law enforcement, people that investigate. The sport cannot have capacity, or we can have very reduced capacity of investigation. And third, last but not least, the regulatory agency where they exist. Even in Europe, I want to thank the Council of Europe now for having achieved that the convention that they wrote has been adopted, even if one country, Malta, didn't accept this convention because it's the host of all the betting companies. But having said that, I mean, this is what has to be clear. Sport cannot cope with this problem alone. We need to open ourselves, and in fact we do. I believe sport put already, especially under the leadership of Thomas Bach, a lot of emphasis on that. We invest in everything. As I said in the list, good governance, my association is recognized as a leader even by the public authority, even if they said that we should do more. But again, I want to remind that we don't have indefinite resources. Even the international federations, they are very different. And not all the money could be put in integrity, even if integrity is a priority. So we have other mission to be fulfilled.
Okay, I wonder if one area that Francesco has already mentioned is it feels that it's critical to this issue, which is transparency. I wonder, Mogens Jensen, if you would just talk a little bit about why that matters.
Well, of course, I think we all know that if you are going to reveal how economics are being moved from one part to another, from one person to another, then you have to have open accounts in order to give membership or audience, the public, the possibility to see how do you use money and what are the money transactions. So open accounts is critical. But just to give an example on a picture of the challenge we are facing is that what triggered my work and the report I made and the proposals I made for the Council of Europe was a report made by Play the Game a couple of years ago, where they've examined 35 Olympic federations, and they have set up a number of relevant criteria of accountability and transparency and so on, democratic elections, and between 50 and 75% of the federations did not live up to half of these criteria.
That's huge.
And that's a huge number, and things have happened since then, for sure. But still, there's a way to go, and that's why I want to emphasize the good step of the IOC to establish, together with OECD and other stakeholders, the IPEX, which is the International Partnership Against Corruption in Sports. And I'm just arguing now, use this IPEX, make it stronger, connect more governments to that, connect more NGOs to that, also critical NGOs to that, and use this structure to set up a global framework, both for defining the standards of good governance, defining a monitoring system, which should be independent, and also defining a sanction system. That can be done. It's just to move on now. And I encourage the IOC to do so, and also for us as parliamentarians and governments, NGOs, to chip in with our part of it. That can take us a great step further.
So can you give us a public assurance now, Francesco, that you're willing to do what Mogens is asking in the context of the IPACs?
Talk with me? Mm-hmm. I think we know our problem much better than everybody else. And I think the first stage, I believe that everybody has to do his own job. This is my message. I urge the government people that we work together in many organizations. Now we open our door to them, to the OECD, to all the people that can contribute to this improvement. But we believe that we do a good job. Obviously, we start not so much ago. We don't believe in a specific measurement the government could bring so much. I am not a great believer in independence. In my opinion, independence not exist if you don't put another small word that is relative. Because when you appoint somebody, even if he's independent, he's not anymore independent, in my opinion. But having said that, this is my personal view, I believe more in competence. And if you know the problem, you can solve the problem. So we really urge the support of the public authority, specifically field. We open completely, I open our project completely. The Council of Europe knows what we are doing. We are setting the third stage with a monitoring unit in which we start perhaps going a little bit further with financial analysis, not in order to make another audit, is not our job, and we don't want to interfere in the organization, but to make more available the culture of risk management that is quite new in the sport organization. So risk management is very important, and we have we live on funding, public and private funding at top level, and so we have some responsibility. So we are progressing very well. We are very happy. Obviously, there is a lot of gap. With our federation, we had the 200, as has been mentioned by Mr. Jensen, we have 200 as the top, and we have federations that are much lower. But the federation, you cannot compare FIFA with the money available in terms of organization with the canoeing federation that is very depending from the Olympic contribution. So they are completely different worlds. So we have to cope with all this different situation, different body. And I believe that we are doing great progress, and I'm very happy because it was not an easy job. Response of the Federation is very positive. So I can reassure Mr. Jensen that we have a great response, even without any total independent, because our monitoring unit is 50-50, is half independent, if you want. Okay. But even without a full independence, we are very satisfied.
Jean-Luc, you wanted to come in there.
Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, I would like to give credit indeed to the IOC in the sense that much progress has indeed been made. But one need to recognize that the corruption is an evolving topic as well. In the last century, it was still allowed in many Western countries to deduct corruption from your taxes. So if you had corruption ongoing within business transactions abroad, you could use that to deduct against your taxes. the Universal Convention Against Corruption dates from 2003, 2005, so it's relatively relevant. I mean, we now realize that corruption is an impediment for economic growth. I mean, it's an impediment for politics. I mean, look what is happening in elections in Brazil. Is an impediment for security as well. I mean, look to certain African countries. So the evolving framework is definitely something which we witness within the IOC as well, and that's a very much positive. But just to tell you that the challenges which we have, I mean, within globalization, organized crime is one of the big winners. Now, if you look at gambling, sports gambling, and you see the patchwork of regulation throughout the entire world among the different countries, then you understand indeed, I mean, the challenges which you have, not only as an IOC, but as well as a UNODC, as an OECD, as a Council of Europe, as the athletes overall, in building that framework and moving that patchwork towards a more harmonious legal framework. But that's work for after tomorrow, I'm afraid.
Of course. Marie, I wonder if you would outline for us how much progress and development you think that IPACS has made. It was founded in 2017, so it's not been around for very long.
We have been pleased with the commitment of everyone who has participated in the work, so this is a sign of that everyone really needs to get very concrete outcomes of that work. And in coming months, a report will be published, evidence-based one, where we have mapped certain bigger sports event. London and Rio Olympics are one of them. Also, the South Africa World Cup is covered. And we have mapped risk management strategies and public procurement frameworks. And based on that, will be also then at the further space, at the further in the coming months, will be then published also a kind of an implementation toolkit, how to really make it happen so that the best practices can be used efficiently. But really also what is needed in the sport organization is training when it comes to this risk management. People have to have the skills in order to identify the entry points of corruptions, because there are so many. When you think about the cycle of a sport event, starting from selection of the site, from land acquisition, from construction, procurement, media contracts, and so on. There are so many spots where you can fail.
And is it your contention that there isn't enough training at the moment?
I think that more is needed. And many of you also took up the transparency issue and also the openness. That is one of the key words. And there is not enough oversight to sports organization compared, for example, how much that is oversight, what governments do and how open it is, how the public money is used there. So that is one of the key words also.
Let's talk a little more about transparency. Alexandro, you're an ambassador for not just your own sport, but for the Olympics in many respects. You know, you're heavily involved in the way in which the Olympics are perceived. And I wonder how difficult it is for you, or how easy it is for you to be able to persuade people that whatever stains corruption have created on the Olympics, that it's still an institution and an organization that you would encourage people to get involved with?
Well, firstly, we are all in this room, and that's a testament to the fact of how much we believe in this movement and the power of sport and how it impacts not only people but nations. And we spoke a lot today about sport breaking down boundaries, and you've heard so many incredible speakers today on the power that it brings and that will overcome the challenges, and we are all here to find those solutions, because it's not just about transparency, but it's also about accountability, and we are all, you know, accountable in some way. And there needs to be, we mentioned this a little earlier, but there needs to be ways for not only athletes but for all of us to come forward in cases where there could be corruption, to come forward without repercussions, so that to have safeguards in place. But also for us to build trust with the public and with athletes again, we need to own the mistakes of the past, and we need to show that we're willing to progress forward and look at how we're governed, but also when we look at term limits of leaders, we look at diversity from all different forms. How are we moving forward so that more new perspectives are in place, that there's checks and balances? We're auditing our organizations at all levels, and I keep stressing that because we speak about corruption sometimes at a very high level, and solutions at more of a global level, and it's important to understand that every nation is different. Every nation has different resources. They're dealing with different athletes. We look at some of the more professional sports versus not, and we need to be able to implement solutions in a customized way and really understand how we're going to implement that to make real change. So I would say, you know, in closing, I know we're over time, that this is something that we all need to collaborate together on, and athletes need to be a part of the conversation. And we need fresh blood as a part of the conversation and be willing to take that risk and really stand in front of that mirror and see where our faults are and where we can address those gaps.
Okay, we have pretty much run out of time, but I just want to throw a very, very, I would say 20 seconds from each of you. Let's start with you, Francesco. You've said that you're very happy with the progress that's been made. I want all of you to come up with one thing that you would like to see within the next 2 years.
I would like to see the people be aware that sport is not anymore the sport of 20 years ago. The complexity is much bigger. An international federation that I represent is not anymore something that controls the three basic missions, rules, competition, and development. Now you have to be a media operation, you have to be, and you have to protect integrity, and you have to announce governance. So what I would like to see is the people, even in sport, understand that.
Let's go to you, Mogens Jensen, next.
Well, I agree with Alexandra that this is different from country to country, culture to culture, but it starts with the values, that we have to have the values, which also is the Olympic values, the UN values of non-corruption, of transparency, of accountability. So I hope that IPACs can be the forum where you, before 2020, can set up global standards for good governance, and also set up a monitoring system for that people can apply to, and for that sake also a sanction system. And I think it's possible.
Marie? And I want to see more transparency, accountability, and openness in the world of sports.
Jean-Luc?
Well, if corruption is disease, then transparency is definitely medication next to the accountability. But behind that is still the need for the moral compass, the values. So I would love to end there.
I'm going to give you the last word because you are the athlete, worthy athlete.
I have noticed that, you know, we seem to have a winning at any cost culture that is becoming more and more and more apparent when we look at issues of corruption and issues of doping. And I would like to see over the next couple of years developing sport at all levels to be a safe place for athletes to feel like their rights are protected, that they are competing in a world that upholds itself with integrity and that lives truly through the Olympic values. And I would like to see every single organization, whether it's the IOC to NOCs to national sporting federations to local clubs, be discussing this topic more and more and more, and really trying to find a balance between this winning at any cost versus the Olympic values and what it means to participate in sport.
Thank you all very much. I hope you saw what I did there in asking them to come up with what they want to see for the next 2 years. They've kind of given us our concluding thoughts. But as is often the way with subjects like this, this really is only the beginning of the conversation. And I would just like to say in conclusion that I do applaud the IOC in wanting to have the conversation. It's, you know, recognizing that there is something that needs to be resolved beyond what's being done currently is a courageous thing to do. So it really only leaves for me to say thank you to everyone on the panel and for your attention. Thank you very much indeed. Enjoy your evening.